Hey, it's Professor Dave. Let's talk terminology.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
So let's take a look at some terminology that is very important in organic chemistry and actually commonly misused. Let's start out by looking at stereospecificity and stereoselectivity. A lot of students think that these terms are interchangeable and synonymous. They actually are not. They mean something very, very particular. So let's start with stereospecificity. We've got an SN2 reaction, very basic reaction, right? We know what's going to happen here. We've got our secondary substrate, CN minus is going to attack, and we're going to displace the bromo group, and then we've got our CN group on there. So regular SN2, and this is stereospecific because out of possible stereochemical outcomes, right, we would think that the CN could be either on the dash or the wedge. It is going to be 100% on the dash. Okay, we're only going to get this product, right? We got 100% that we're never going to get CN on the wedge. Now, the reasoning for this is because of the SN2 mechanism, right? We know that in order for substitution to occur, the incoming nucleophile is going to have to access the lowest unoccupied molecular orbital of the substrate. And as it happens, that is the antibonding orbital that is precisely 180 degrees from the carbon leaving group bond. So the nucleophile can only approach in one very specific direction. That's why we're only going to get one very specific stereochemical outcome. So stereospecificity, or a stereospecific reaction, means we specifically get only one outcome out of any stereochemical possibilities and not any other, right? So specificity, you get a specific product. So in contrast, let's look at stereoselectivity. This is a little bit more nuanced, but say, for example, we remember hydrogenation over platinum metal. This is a very basic addition reaction. We have this alkene here. We know that we're going to hydrogenate, and we know that this is heterogeneous catalysis. So we have that solid platinum surface that is going to provide the hydrides. The substrate is going to lower down and then receive the hydrides, therefore getting hydrogenated. But the thing is, we've got this methyl. So the substrate can approach in one of two ways. Either the substrate can approach with the methyl sticking up like that, right? The methyl sticking away from the platinum surface, or it can approach this way with the metal sticking down towards the platinum surface. Now, for very obvious reasons, one of these two situations is going to be more sterically favorable, right? The methyl sticking down is going to be not quite as favorable energetically because of the slight additional repulsion that is going to be occurring. So as we can see, if it lowers onto the platinum metal such that the hydrogens add on the bottom and push that methyl up to give us the cis dimethyl product, that's going to be more favorable, and that is reflected in the product mixture. We've got 68% cis, right? We've got 68% there. Whereas the other situation, where it approaches with the methyl down, so this original methyl is down, and then the new methyl gets pushed up, that would give us the trans product. That's only 32. And so the reason we call that selectivity, this is a stereoselective reaction, because there's more than one stereochemical possible outcome, and we do get both. However, the system will select one of those products to be more prominent in the product mixture than the other. So we do get both, but we get more of one than the other in a way that is statistically significant and reflects some certain aspect about the substrate or about the reaction in general. In this case, it was all about sterics, right? It was about the sterics of this methyl group, where that methyl group was pointing for the reaction to go. Just one more example, very similar, but just to kind of get the hang of this. We're going to do a reduction here. We've got lithium aluminum hydride. We've got a ketone. So we know that a hydride, we know what's going to happen here, right? This is going to attack, and this will pick up a proton, and we're going to get an alcohol, right? But which way is this hydride going to attack from? This is an sp2 center, therefore trigonal planar. So the hydride can come in like this. It's going to come this way, or it can come from behind. It can come from behind there. And so that's going to create two different products in terms of stereochemistry. So one thing that could happen, the hydride could attack from the back and push the new hydroxyl forward, because we're going from sp2 to sp3 center. So we're going from trigonal planar to tetrahedral. So it could push that new hydroxyl forward, and that would be this. Or it can attack from the front like this and push that new hydroxyl to the back. And so that would be this. And so there is some discrepancy here because of this methyl that is projecting out like this. So the sheer fact that this methyl is projecting in this direction with respect to the plane of the rest of the molecule, there is a little bit more steric hindrance, right, associated with the hydride approaching from this side. It's going to feel more steric hindrance from this methyl than if it was to approach on the other side. And so that means that the activation energy associated with reduction from one side versus the other is actually going to be slightly different. It will need a little bit more kinetic energy to be able to approach from this side and successfully reduce. And again, that is reflected in the product mixture. So we're going to get 76% cis on these groups because it's more energetically favorable, or lower activation energy, for the hydride to attack from the back. And that would give us this, versus 24% getting the trans, where it will overcome this higher energy barrier and attack from the front, push that hydroxyl back, and we get this. So again, it's stereoselectivity because we do get more than one product. It is just that one is favored over the other, or the rest if there are multiple within the product mixture, which is different from stereospecificity, where we get only one product. Okay, so now let's look at regiospecificity and regioselectivity. This is going to be very similar to what we just looked at. We're just talking about regiochemistry now instead of stereochemistry. So first, going over regiospecificity, this should be very, very familiar. This is just a regular Markovnikov hydrohalogenation. Again, a very common addition reaction, and we don't need to go over the mechanism. We know that this pi bond is going to protonate. We're going to get the secondary carbocation instead of the primary, and so we're going to get 100% of this structural isomer. So we know that there are ways to go anti-Markovnikov, right? If we did this in the presence of hydroxides, we could get the other regioisomer. But the point is that here, we're only going to get the bromine there, and we're not going to get the bromine there at all. We're going to get 100% the Markovnikov product. So we call that regiospecificity. This is a regiospecific reaction because that's all we get. Now, to talk about regioselectivity, remember, when we looked at E2 elimination, we looked at Zaitsev and Hoffman elimination products. And we looked at that in a couple different contexts, but this is actually a great way to show regioselectivity as well. Let's say that we have this, let's call that bromine. So that's going to be a bromo group or something. So we're going to do a regular elimination. Now, we know that there's more than one proton available for elimination, and we can get different structurally different products depending on which one we get. So let's say we've got ethoxide here. Let's go ahead and get this proton. Remember, we're going to heat that up a little bit, make sure we don't get any, we're going to promote elimination that way. So let's go ahead and get this proton. And we're going to do that, and then we're going to kick this off like that. So if we do that, we're going to get the pi bond right there. And if we get the pi bond right there, that's going to give us the Zaitsev product. That's the more substituted alkene product, which, as we recall from another tutorial, this is the thermodynamically favored product, right? This is the more stable product, sits lower on an energy diagram, and that's why we're going to get more of it, right? So the thermodynamics are driving is what's driving this here. But by contrast, right, we could get any of the protons. There's three protons here, three protons here on those two methyls. So six chemically equivalent protons that we could also get to get the other product. So we could go over here and we could get that, and we could kick this off that way. And that would give us the Hoffman product, and we're only going to get about 20% of the Hoffman product. Remember, that would be kinetically favored. This is the less thermodynamically favorable. It's not as low on an energy diagram. So remember, in order to get that, we would have had to use a much bulkier base like tert butoxide. And so this is an example of regioselectivity because we're getting two products here, and we're getting 80% one, 20% the other. So there is a selectivity. The system will select one product over the other in the product mixture. And so with stereoselectivity, we saw that sterics were maybe the primary factor. There can be electronic factors that drive stereoselectivity as well. But we saw sterics in two examples. Here we're seeing electronic influence that's guiding the regioselectivity. And so that's a Zaitsev-Hoffman thing. We're talking about a thermodynamically favored product versus a kinetically favored product. So again, regiospecificity, only getting one product, regioselectivity, mixture of two or more products, but one is selected for by the system and is more dominant in the product mixture. So that's a little bit of information about stereospecificity and stereoselectivity and regiospecificity and regioselectivity. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.